Hello friends, welcome to my channel, myself Parag Dambulkar. In this video, we will discuss important topic in our programming languages, that is binding. So, in our program, there are various components or various entities. For example, there are some variables, there are some functions, we call them routines, those are defined. There are many statements. Now, for all these components, there are some properties. So for every component, there are some properties, and that properties we call as attribute. For example, if we take variable, so suppose if I define integer x, so x is a name given to that variable, then int is a data type, that is integer type. Then when you say integer int x, so some memory is allocated to that variable. So all these are the properties of that particular variable. In the same way, there are some properties for the function. So for example, name of that function, what are the formal parameters that we define for that function, then how parameters are passed to that function. So maybe it is called by a value, called by a reference, like this. So all these are properties of a routine or a function. Then various statements. So what action can be done by the statement? So that is the property of that particular statement. So every component in our program has some properties, and that properties are called as attributes. Now see, while specifying the exact nature of these attributes or specifying the values of these properties or these attributes is called as binding. So whenever these properties are defined or when some values are allocated to these properties, it is called as binding. Allocation of values to the properties are specifying exact nature of these attributes of these components is called as binding. These properties, values of these properties, all this attribute information is saved in some repository, and that is called as descriptor. So all this information is saved in a repository, and that repository we call it descriptor. Now see, there are various types of binding. So based on whether that binding is fixed or it is modifiable, so based on that there are two types. One is a static binding and another is a dynamic binding. So if that binding is permanent, then it is called a static binding. So binding which does not get changed, binding which is not changing, is called as static binding. While a binding is getting changed, then it is called as dynamic binding. For example, variable. So for variable, suppose sometimes it is x is equal to 5, later on it becomes x is equal to 10. So it is a dynamic binding because value of x is getting changed. While if you consider constant, so value of constant is not getting changed, so it is a static binding. So here we will take example. So for variables, so variable is an entity in our program. So these are the properties or attributes. We are showing it as a tuples. So there are 5 tuples or 5 properties of variables. So name is name, that name of the variable. Then scope, so whether it is for a particular function or it is a particular for a complete program, so that is a scope, wherever that variable is accessed. Then type of the variable, L value, that is a memory location, what address is allocated to that variable, and R underscore value is the actual value saved in that variable, that is a location of that variable. So these are the 5 properties shown by 5 tuples for that variable. Then routine. Routine is a, it can be a function, it can be a procedure. So routine can be represented by these five tuples. In the same way, we have represented variables. In the same way, we can represent attributes of routine by these five tuples. So these five tuples are this. Same five tuples. So name of a function, that is the one attribute. Then function scope. So where that function can be accessed. So for example, within a package or outside the package, something like that. Then function has a return type. So that return type of the function, that is a type of a function. Then these statements of a function are saved in some memory location. It is saved in a main memory. So whatever the memory addresses are used to save the statements of the function, that is the L underscore value, and what are the actual statements saved in that memory location is called as R underscore value. Then there are at what time this binding occurs is called as binding time. At what time this binding occurs, so we call them binding time. Now see, so there are four binding times. First is language definition time binding. Means at in the beginning, when that language was designed, so see, for example, for C language in the 1970s, when it was designed, so at that time what binding was done, that is called as the language definition time binding. Simple example, so when language was designed, so at that time it was decided there will be integer data type, there will be a float data type, there will be character data type, like this. So at designing time, there will be the if, there will be while, there will be for. So all these conditionals, looping statements, those were decided at the language design time only. So this is called as language definition time binding. So binding occurs at language definition at designing time, that is called a language definition time binding. Then when language is implemented, so when language is actually implemented on any particular hardware or on any computer architecture, so it is called as language implementation type binding. So for example, integers, how bytes are saved in memory, so it may get changed as per the hardware. So when language is same, but when we implement that on different computer architectures or different computer hardware, so its implementation gets changed. This is called as language implementation time binding. When we compile our program, so at the time whatever the bindings happen, that is called as compile time binding. Why? When we run that program, so whatever the binding happens, that is called as execution time binding. Simple example, suppose we are defining some variable, and in that variable, suppose we are allocating some value. So suppose we are writing x is equal to 5. So, but if we are taking value of x from the user, so this binding happens at execution time. In the same way, when we use calloc or malloc function, at runtime we allocate memory to the variable. So this is execution time or runtime binding. Now see, there are three different compile time bindings. So first is binding chosen by programmer. So for example, integer x. So integer x, that programmer had decided the type of variable x will be int. So that is the binding chosen by the programmer. Binding chosen by the translator. So when program is compiled, at the time some relative addresses are allocated to the variables. So those relative addresses are not chosen by the programmer. Those relative addresses are chosen by the compiler. And when that program is run, At that time, actual addresses are allocated to that variable. So that is the binding done by the loader. So in this way, there are three different compile time bindings. In the same way, there are two types of execution time bindings. So one is on entry to a subprogram or block. So for example, when control goes to any function, so at that time, whatever the bindings happens with the formal parameter, this is the type of on entry to a subprogram or block binding. While second type is at arbitrary points during execution. So for example, assignment statement. So at one time x is equal to 5. So that is the binding at that time. After some time, suppose x is equal to 6. So that is the binding at that particular time instant. After some time again x is equal to 8. So that is the binding happen at later time. So these are the different types of execution time binding. So there are four different types of binding times. So one is when language is defined, then when that language is actually implemented on a hardware, when program is compiled at the time whatever the bindings happens, and when the program is run at the time whatever the bindings happens. So there are four different binding times. Now we'll see one example. So this is one simple statement, x is equal to x plus 10. So here we are adding 10 to the value of x. So we'll consider different cases and we'll see what is the binding time. Now see, set of types for variable x means what are the possible types of x. So this binding happens at language definition time. So when language was defined, so at that time it is decided, so what will be the type, what are the possible types for the variables, for example integer, float, character. So at language definition time it is decided that how many types that language will support. So set of types for variable x is the language definition time binding. Then type of variable x. So what is the exact type of this variable x? So it is at compile time it is decided what will be the type of variable x. Then set of possible values for variable x. So what will be the possible values of x? So if it is integer type, so there will be some different range. If it is a float, then there will be different range. So it is decided at language definition time. So when language is designed, when language was defined, at that time it is decided what will be the possible values for the variables. Then value of variable x. So what will the value of x? So at runtime, it will be decided. So what will the value of this x? So when this statement is executed, at that time it is decided what will be the value of x. So value of variable x, it is the runtime binding. Means at runtime that binding occurs. Then representation of constant 10. So here 10 is a constant, but if we write like this, TEN, that is not considered as a constant. But if we write 10, then it is considered as a constant. So when it is decided, so when this language is defined, at that time this binding is decided or this binding is done. So when language was defined, at that time it is decided that 10 will be a constant. Then properties of operator plus. So here plus we are using for the addition. So when language was defined, at that time it was decided plus will be used for the addition. In the same way, minus for the subtraction, into asterisk symbol for the multiplication, like. But in case of C++ language, where we are overloading this operator, so at the time we may use this plus for some different purpose. So for example, integer addition or real addition or character addition, something like that. So if it is the case where we overload any operator, so that will be the compile time binding. So in this way, for this simple statement, according to these cases, different binding times will be there. So friends, I hope you like this video. If yes, click on like, subscribe to the channel and don't forget to press bell icon so that you will get notification of my next video. So stay connected. Thank you.